fights. Like the blowout at the college in the college in the Midwest where we were all screaming at each other.
You're all screaming at me, what do you mean?
The one that I always, always look back on with such regret and such sadness is what a total cock I was when we played in Portland that one time with Rancid, and I got really drunk and I was like,
I don't remember that.
Unleashing every kind of insult and derogatory thing. It was you and me got into it, and I felt so bad. Like, I remembered it. Like, I felt bad the next day, but I felt so bad, like, maybe about a year ago, I was remembering that day, and I was like, God, man, did I ever apologize for that? Like,
did we get in a fight?
We got in a big fight. And I was like, fuck you, I'm sleeping in the van. And I slept in the van. I was like crying all night. I'm like, why am I such an asshole? I hate myself.
Oh my God, I don't even remember that.
It was the worst, man.
I just remember that was a shitty show in Portland.
Oh, I thought it was. I thought
we did okay, but the crowd hated us, so.
No, they didn't. I don't remember it that way.
There were a bunch of.
I just remember being a total douchebag.
Oh, I don't remember that at all. So. You're obviously forgiven, because I don't remember. What are you guys on about in there?
Talking about. Yeah, were you waiting for us?
Yeah!
Well, no, it didn't. No! I didn't know.
I go, come on, let's go get the 20 years of coffee.
I thought you were in here doing something.
No, we're just blah, blah,
blah. Oh my God, knock on the window or something.
Well, we did.
We threw a snare drum at the window. One, two, three.
Pansy Division's reason for existence is me just trying to deal with my alienation, trying to do something positive with something that seemed to be a negative.
We were trying to be what we didn't see when we were growing up. Let's be everything that we could possibly have wanted at that age.
This is what I've always wanted to do, and in a really unapologetic way where I can be whoever I want to be. And for me, that's awesome.
I can't name a heterosexual band that writes about fucking so much.
I'm from Peoria, Illinois, which is a town that is often made fun of. For good reasons, though, there's plenty of other towns that are just as ordinary, normal, and boring.
When I finally decided I was gay, it was after having gone through every other self-brainwashing process to think, well, maybe I'm not if I'm like this. But then you finally run out of options and you think, yeah, I've really got to face this.
I found it difficult to actually decide that I was gay, and it took me till I left Peoria and went to college in Champaign, Urbana. It was a much different setting, and that's where I finally dealt with the issue.
Originally from Seattle. I was a musician since I was a kid. I've been playing music all my life. So I started off on, you know, the typical instruments they start you out on when you're a kid. I had piano lessons, I had recorder, I was always singing. I took trumpet for a while and then I got a blister on my lip and said enough of that.
As soon as I realized that the feelings that I had were attached to the sexual end of it and that I was really homosexual, I decided to give myself over to Christ, you know.
Oh,
and
really?
Yeah,
you want to get Christian for a while?
Oh, very much so. Wow. I was studying to be a minister for a long time, and I'm a minister now, but...
Are you?
Well, sort of. It's a mail-order ministry.
My first band formed when I was in Champaign as I was graduating from college. That's just too much to comprehend. That band was called The Outnumbered. We were ambitious, and we did tours. We played a lot of shows. We were really active. And that kind of seemed to have run its course. So I thought when I decided I was ready to move on from Champaign that I was done playing music.
I'd been in several bands in Seattle.
Why don't you come back and see me?
One of them had two girl singers up front. I could write songs for them and not change the pronouns. That folded because there was just too much pressure. So I moved to San Francisco with a couple people, and I was about 28 and I thought, all right, I'm done, because I knew about the 30-year rule. You're not going to get signed in the music business if you're over 30. So I thought, it's going to take 2 to 3 years for a band. I'm already going to be over 30. So I gave it up. I'd made an agreement to myself that music was no longer going to be a career choice. It was going to be, I'm going to do things only for the fun of it.
I hear the gays go to San Francisco. That's so far away from here.
So I came out here and I felt really alienated by what was considered gay culture or the gay scene. One of the rude awakenings about coming out and being gay was that, you know, a lot of gay life takes place in bars and clubs, and the music that gay people generally listen to is music that, well before I knew that it was gay music, I just never liked. I'd meet these gay people and they would just be on this sort of narrow disco, show tunes, whatever kind of path. And I found it very puzzling, the fact that I grew up and had all this interest in music and was really focused on music made it worse, because, you know, that was sort of the area that I was interested in, and it was really betraying me that way. And it was like having a double life. I had a music life and then I had a gay life.
Coming out of the 80s, which was a big sort of like bummer for a lot of people, especially for gay people, AIDS, HIV still being a major issue in the forefront. Certainly in the wake of ACT UP and Queer Nation, there was a renewed sense of optimism that shit was gonna change.
There was kind of this sort of queercore, homocore thing that had been bubbling up through the Bay Area scene.
And that was a movement, the homocore, queercore, whatever you wanna call it. You had the homocore magazine with Tom Jennings over here in San Francisco. You had Bruce LaBruce up in Toronto. You had a bunch of different folks from a bunch of different cities who were out and queer.
And this new generation of queer politics was something that was really coming about then. A lot of people trying to redefine what gay culture really was. And so really we had this sort of loose network of bands that sounded all very different, coming from different aspects, but all kind of united under the same idea that we're going to make music that's somehow, in some way, political and politicized, but also under some umbrella. You could call it queercore, or queer punk, or whatever.
And at the same time, there was this whole thing called Riot Girl that was happening in Olympia. And you had, you know, Bikini Kill, and then there were dyke bands like Team Dresh. So there was a large presence of females in music, which hadn't happened in a long time.
It was like this kind of perfect storm of events, and so it was just natural for us to be excited about, you know, Tribe A, Pansy Division, you know, Outpunk Records, all that stuff.
The gay lifestyle is becoming more mainstream, not only in the pop culture and in today's society, but also in the music world. What do you guys attribute that to?
Us.
Yeah, a little bit.
I mean, obviously, yeah.
Times have changed, and we've helped those times change, even though we're not a huge band. Because when we started the band, nobody was out in pop music. No one. And,
92, right?
Yeah, 91, 92. There was, all the people that are out now, like Katie Lang and Melissa Etheridge and the Pet Shop Boys and Rob Halford and Michael Stipe, none of these people were out. All these people had rumors about being out, a lot of them back then. And at a certain point, being gay, you thought, why won't anybody come out? If there's such a stigma, then we'll be the ones to break the stigma.
After realizing that I had a purpose to do music again, I thought, okay, if I really have a reason apart from just, you know, self-gratification, wow, I can make this music, I thought, that's really what's going to motivate me to do a band again.
There was talk about this queer band called Pansy Division. I was interested in them even before I heard the music, just because I thought, that's a good idea. Basically a pop-punk band, only with queer lyrics. I was intrigued, and I said, we got to find out about that.
John was the one who formed Pansy Division. He's the one who made up the idea, had the songs. He had basically the whole first album recorded before I'd even met him.
I had to go back to Illinois for a wedding, and one of my friends had just opened a recording studio, and he said, you know, if you ever come back to Champaign, I'll record you for really cheap. And then, like 6 months later, I thought, hey, I can actually do this. We basically recorded the whole album as a demo.
One, two, three, four!
your face today.
You know, some people say, oh, that sounds kind of thin. But I actually like the way that it sounds. The vocals are really cranked up, maybe a little too much, because that was what I was afraid was going to happen, was that the message wouldn't get through, and that was really important.
We're the buttfuckers of rock and roll. We want to sock it to your hole.
And some people have said, you know, the problem with Pansy Division is the message is, you know, more important than the music. But to me, they're inseparable, that you can't have this kind of message without some sort of music that matches it in some way.
I think that it was interesting contextualizing Pansy Division in a punk scene, because they really weren't typical sounding for punk bands at the time. They were pretty light. And a lot of people would love the excuse to say that Pansy Division is not punk. But the irony, of course, is that, you know, John was punk when these people were in their diapers.
Fantasizing about boys in the shower. With his long, long hair and pouty lips. Cute little buddy.
I had played a few shows on my own as Pansy Division. And it was just me and a guitar.
The show was John singing along to the different version of the demo tape. I wasn't quite prepared to sign him up for Lookout at the time, although I had every intention of doing so if the band ever actually became a band.
And after playing for a few months in San Francisco in 91, all my friends and people who saw me play said, you should really get a band.
How'd you meet up with John? He put an ad in the trade paper, a local trade paper, that said looking for queer musicians into Buzzcocks, Ramones, and early Beatles, and I was like, no way, that's me, who's this, you know, and so met John through that.
I was pretty sure right away that he was, I just had a good sense that he really got what I was getting at.
I just thought, oh, this is going to be hilarious, I can't wait to see what, you know, what the clubs think when we play the clubs.
This before, we take off our clothes before in the door. 8 hours of work is especially tough when 3 times a day is barely enough. I got the carrot, you got the stick. Start to nibble, I start to lick, and we get our bodies all hot and sweaty and runny, and then we fuck like bunnies.
When we began, I thought we'd be playing music for people like us who were in our 30s and sort of dissatisfied with the options gay culture had offered. Are we talking about 20 people, 30 people somewhere? That was really kind of what I had in mind.
Bunnies, 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 bunnies.
Stop the tape, Joey.
I thought, okay, good, found a bass player. That was quick, that was easy. He was like the only one I ever considered. But the drummer thing was very difficult.
I found Chris pretty much at the beginning of my search for a band, and so from then on it's been he and I trying to find compatible people to play with.
At that time we were asking all our friends if they knew any drummers, especially gay drummers, and Jay Padgett was the first drummer we played live with.
Well, why don't you introduce the members of your band?
Okay, this is Chris Freeman on bass guitar. Jay Padgett on drums, and I'm Jon Ginoli.
Right.
He eventually told me he had a bass player and then eventually a drummer, and then they started playing shows.
So true.
ambiguity I wouldn't try to say.
Jay was in a weird and popular San Francisco band called Thinking Fellers Union Local 282. Even though Jay had this other band, he agreed to sort of take us on as a side project because he thought it would be fun. But we started doing too well and taking up too much of his time because his other band toured and had a lot of commitments. So we had to find a replacement. After Jay left, we had David Ward. And David was bi, and he lived with his girlfriend. And they were really great. And David was a really hunky, good-looking kind of guy who would always take his shirt off at the show. So he was very popular.
We're Pansy Division, the queer rock and roll experience from San Francisco.
Don't care about heterosexuality. Rock, rock, rock and roll queer bar, because that's not what I want to be.
Pansy Division took off pretty fast. And I think one of the reasons was that we were very frank about things.
Well, in terms of content, it seemed like we had been wanting to hear bands addressing gay themes for a long time. It seemed like so much of the rock music that we like seemed so overwhelmingly heterosexual in nature. And we got tired of switching the pronouns after a while. And there's plenty of gay musicians out there doing dance-oriented music, Erasure and Culture Club and Jimmy Somerville and people like that, but not too many people doing rock. No one being as openly gay as we are, so we thought, let's try it.
It's not even so much about a gay lifestyle, it's that it's their sex lives laid out in kind of extremely graphic detail.
What was the inspiration for this song, Hippie Dude?
I was inspired by seeing really cute long-haired boys walking down Hate Street of ambiguous or yet to be determined sexual orientation. So they inspired me.
I wanted the songs I sing about to be joyous and to be fun.
Our whole approach was to be as happy and celebratory as possible because that's sort of what people in general would think was not what the gay experience was about.
Some people would say things like, you know, well, you're just singing about homosexuality. That seems so limited. And I thought, yeah, are people going to say that heterosexuality is limited?
Is the song on your new cassette?
Yes, it's on our cassette, which is called Undressed and is available. It's a full-length album available on tape in most, several local record stores. Select ones friendly to us.
At some point, John gave me this little, like, box with, like, a Pansy Division logo spray painted on it. And inside there was, like, some flyers and some other stuff and a condom. Because apparently people can't find condoms in 1992.
We had made all these cassettes at home, and we were putting them in bookstores, like Different Light, which is a gay bookstore, and we put them in a couple of the record stores, and we kept logs of that. So when we got to talking to the independent labels in the Bay Area, we said, look, we've already sold 250 cassettes. You know, think how much we'd sell on vinyl.
So John gave me a tape, and I remember listening to it, and I liked it, but I thought, there's no way in hell, no way in hell this is going to be released by any reasonably sized label. I just thought it was so out there content-wise that I really didn't see anyone taking a chance on it. And so I started this record label and fanzine, which was called Outpunk, and I was going to be the one that was going to be putting out the queer punk stuff. And at the time, I also put out bands like Tribe 8.
Baby, ride my bicycle and pay me to be free.
And got as my co-pilot Muckle Tio Fairy, Sister George. Many of these bands didn't have an outlet for their recordings, and I was in a perfect spot to do something about that. So eventually I put out a Pansy Division single on Outpon called Bill and Ted's Homosexual Adventure.
It's no bogus journey, it's their heart's true yearning. It's time for Bill and Ted's Homosexual Adventure to begin.
Both Alternative Tentacles and Lookout were vying for Pansy Division when they first started.
Jello got very interested. Jello was right on target with us from the beginning.
Hi, it's Jello Biafra calling for John. I'm back from the Oregon thing. I talked to all three members of Nirvana at once, and they had absolutely no problem with Smells Like Queer Spirit. So once again, I will lobby for you to make that the B-side of the Christmas single or whatever. That's the best of the new stuff. Talk to you later. Bye.
The first thing that interested me was more the whole aesthetics and concept of the idea. I mean, it was good that they were doing a kind of music that basically fit into what I was specializing in at Lookout, which was pop punk. As soon as they had something that was reasonably approximated to band, I was like, yeah, let's make a record.
You'll probably get sweaters, underwear, and socks, but what you'd really like for Christmas is a nice hard cock. You deserve a cute boy who's horny and queer to make the most out of Christmas cheer. I want to be your Christmas present. I want to be your Christmas queer. I want to be your Christmas present. Have a homo Christmas this year.
I have to admit that when he told me that Lookout was doing it, I thought he was lying. I thought it was a joke. I really didn't think that Lookout would want to put out a Pansy Division record.
There's a few straight guys I know. There's a few straight guys I've blown.
Our audience is younger than we thought it would be. We ended up with a lot more teenagers than I expected.
Me and John would just sit in his room and cry at some of the letters we get from 14-year-olds in Alabama, saying, you know, my parents don't know, I keep your records hidden, don't write me back, I'm really afraid, but your records make me feel better. I thought, oh my God, if I had something like that at that age. And we realized, okay, here's pockets of people, we're getting mail from these areas.
I thought, I think Pansy Division could do a tour.
We basically cashed in all of our vacation time, and we did a quick whirlwind 3-week tour.
I think 23 days, like 19 shows, I think. And we played small clubs and had, you know, maybe, you know, 50, 75 people in a lot of places, but we were a brand new band. It was our first record, and we had no idea if, you know, people would be there waiting to set our van on fire or attack us.
When we first went out, we were all very afraid. I made a specific time that I was going to call my roommate every day, and then I was, you know, she had our tour itinerary, she's like, if you don't call at this time, I'm going to report to the police that you were lost somewhere, you know, because we had no idea. We thought maybe we might get killed, you know, especially in the Bible Belt, you know, find out this queer band is out playing to their kids, you know.
I'd been on tour before with the Outnumbered. Chris and David had never been on tour, so it was all new to them, and everybody was really thrilled about how well it went.
And we were like, okay, this is viable now.
Wow, this could actually be a career.
We could actually do something and make an impact with this.
Yes, we can do this. You know, at some point, we might be able to quit our jobs. When you do your first album, you don't know if anybody's going to hear it. You don't know if it's going to have any impact. The fact that our record did have impact and did gain an audience made us approach the songs differently when we were coming up with songs for the second album.
We just started writing like crazy, and John had a big backlog of songs, so he and I just went through his songs. I maybe made some suggestions about lyrics or chords.
I'd written a bunch of funny songs, encouraged that, you know, the kinds of stuff that I wanted to do was being accepted and going over well.
Even they understand, it's not a camel's face, but a sexual gland. They give pleasure, let there be no doubt. I like having one in my mouth. I wanna touch your Joe Camel.
Your Joe Camel.
I wanna touch your Joe Camel.
Your Joe Camel.
And while we're at it, reach down and grab it. Touch my Joe Camel.
David, though, is this sort of big, hulking guy, played his drums really politely.
For what he liked to play normally, he was great at doing that. But for what we needed, it was never fast enough, it was never solid enough, it was never, you know, like that. It just, he didn't have the power to be able to cut it.
It was being in the recording studio with David was when we realized, you know, we just needed a harder hitter.
It was a little sad, because he was such a sweetheart and easy to tour with and such a nice guy.
And David bowed out very nicely, although he did come back to play with us later in a pinch when another drummer situation had fallen through. And then we played with another David, David Ayer, and we got along fine, but there were some mutual musical disagreements. So he ended up doing a single with us.
Fuck buddy, fuck buddy.
And then he left. The whole time that the band was getting more active, putting out singles, Chris was still kind of hedging his bets. He just didn't think the band was going to last. And when he first started playing with us, he was in three different bands, and he figured that we were the least likely to actually make it.
I didn't really have the thought that Pansy Division had anything that was going to go anywhere. So I didn't think of the political issues. I didn't think of any of these types of issues.
One of the drummers that he played with in one of these other bands ended up playing on our second album and doing some shows with us, and his name is Liam. I think he did 23 songs, and it took less than 100 hours in the studio to record and mix. That's really fast. We were just keeping it simple, not doing too many overdubs. Liam was a straight guy who could not handle some of our lyrics.
Buying a dildo, so hard to decide. Extra long, extra thick, extra wide.
We basically said, this isn't working out. It's in spring of 94 that Green Day asked us if we wanted to open for them on tour.
Now, you did Green Day. That is a huge thing. Everyone knows about that. Yes. You opened for Green Day, which for our street audience who maybe be watching other, maybe paying attention to other kinds of music, it's what would you call it? It's a very hardcore sort of,
it's punk,
not hardcore,
pop.
It's very
poppy, but it's got that punk edge, sort of like the Buzzcocks.
Green Day were on the same label as us. They were on Lookout, and I think they knew that they were destined to be big, and everyone at the label knew they were destined to be big. It was just a matter of the proper exposure.
They were coming from the underground scene and were trying to get through to the mainstream. But at the same time, once they started getting there, they realized that, you know, the mainstream audience really didn't understand things that their underground audience took for granted.
With their MTV success came a whole new audience that didn't care if they were listening to Guns N' Roses or Green Day, you know, just rock, man, rock. And so they thought, well, let's play with their heads.
Oh,
you know, let's maybe see what happens to them.
We had just parted with Liam, and we had given ourselves 5 months to find a new drummer. However, Green Day wanted to go on tour in 6 weeks, and we had to find a drummer.
So the first leg was Butch.
And unfortunately, he really wasn't too good of a drummer.
We were like, oh, we've made a big mistake. But we had to go.
Opportunities only come along once in a while, so you can't say, oh, wait, I don't think we're quite ready. Can you, like, call us again in 8 months or something when we're ready with our new drummer? No, you just do the best you can.
And it must have been very interesting to open huge arenas.
Well, yeah, and when we started off, they had just come out with Longview on MTV, so that we got onto their tour just as they were just starting to crack. And the first couple shows were like 1,000 seaters. And then as the tour got, you know, progressed, we were playing to bigger and bigger places until, you know, we finally played Madison Square Garden with them, and it was like,
wow, you did the garden.
For the big Coliseum tour part of it, we got Danny Panic from Screeching Weasel. He was the best. He was awesome on that tour.
Gone from having our top crowd being probably about 150 people, and now we're playing to 10, 12, 15,000 people a night. We did start winning over some of the Green Day fans, but you know, some were just horrified.
You know, as we went along, we started to gear our set more towards offending the maximum number of jocks in the audience as we could. So, because that's what we felt we were there to do.
And didn't you say you got things thrown? I mean, wasn't kind of interesting?
Tons of stuff thrown at us, but we had them going. You know, you'd see these jocks, you know, they'd flip us off, and you're like,
you know, I'm in charge.
Yeah, I'm in charge now. You just sit right back down, girl.
Chris, especially on stage, would, you know, make comments to elicit squeals of delight and laughter and acceptance.
How many girls are there here tonight?
And they would scream, and it was just like Beatle level loud, really loud. And then we'd say, well, how many girls know that all guys are assholes? And they would just scream even louder. And you're like, oh, see all these guys up here with their fingers in the air? They're homophobic. They hate fags. They probably hate girls, too, so don't date them. And quickly the hands would go down in their pockets. And
that's incredible, going out in front of, you know, this, you know, your friend's first arena tour, and then you have, like, tens of thousands of douchebags in front of you who are like, faggot, faggot, blah, blah, blah. And you're like, that's right, we're Pansy Division. Brilliant.
There were two times on the Green Day tour where the promoters tried to bump us from the bill. And at that point, Green Day were soaring so high and were like the band in demand that that was how they used their power. They said, this is the band we want to have open for us. If you don't want them to open, we'll get a gig somewhere else.
So we were like, oh my God, that's really great, you know? Because putting their own shows on the line for us was really something.
And to have a band like Pansy Division along made people question things, examine things, and it said something about the people that Green Day were.
And just the huge brass balls that both Pansy Division and Green Day had to go on that tour together.
Did that broaden your base? Or do you think that you got some of those people went out and bought your CDs? I mean, that's the key.
Yes, our sales went up dramatically after that, and our exposure, I'm sure most people know who we are, maybe not have heard us, but now, you know, he's got our stickers on his guitar, and they were wearing our shirts on Saturday Night Live and stuff, so I think people know who we are, it's completely great exposure. They've been total sweethearts to us, yeah.
It was probably the single best thing that could have happened to the whole queercore phenomenon in the 90s. Because I think that a lot of people in the media and music critics would have liked to have just written the whole genre off as being not significant. But I think because Green Day insisted on putting Pansy Division front and center, it lent a certain authenticity and legitimized not just Pansy Division, but the whole movement.
I'm Kurt Loder with MTV News. Queer punk, homocore, whatever you call them, there's a new breed of proudly gay punk bands making a big noise these days. Chief among them, San Francisco's delightfully poppy Pansy Division, which got a lot of attention after Green Day hired the group as its opening act on a U.S. tour last fall. Other homocore acts abound. Olympia Washington's Team Dresh pioneered the form, while some, like Toronto's Fifth Column, have been around since the late 80s, and others are just revving up. Why should those of the heterosexual persuasion care? Well, because of the music. Here's the story.
Hi, honey. I'm homo. Green Day and The Offspring aren't the only in-your-face, angst-ridden punkers these days. Pansy Division is leading the charge of a scene called Queer Punk.
Someday I'll find a guy who means something more.
The majority of the audience just looks like, what is this? Because it's so in your face. And it becomes quite a shock. And then I think once they go home, they're like, okay, what was that? And then it starts to hit them. And hopefully they come back with a different attitude than they had before.
Queer punk is just a general term, but it's basically out queer people making music they love for themselves, for a queer audience. Singing about their issues, what's important to them. They're like, right on, we're queer, we're out there, we rock.
And that's just what Pansy Division did this past fall, touring with multi-platinum Green Day.
I just thought they were just a great band, you know, they're really catchy. And I think it, you know, there's a lot, you know, more to, you know, punk rock than, you know, Green Day and Offspring videos, that's for sure. Their lyrics are blatant, just spewing homosexuality, and I think it's great. You know, I think it's the future of what's gonna happen to rock and roll music.
Exposing Green Day's large audience to queer punk should help other homocore bands get noticed, like Chainsaw Kittens and Fifth Column, an all-lesbian band. But more importantly, the music will reach young audiences, gay and straight.
Right on to them for at least putting the issue forth to all the kids that came to the Green Day show who maybe wouldn't have had to think about these things before. And maybe they didn't even think that much about it, but it opened up an avenue for communication, you know, for discussion between kids.
It's really something that we wanted and we didn't have when we were that age. So now that we're going out and playing to Green Day's audience, which is predominantly teenage, at least who's coming to the shows, it feels really good that way.
That's the news for now. We'll be back with more later here on MTV.
So we got all this attention suddenly, and right then was when Pile Up came out. That's our third album.
I can't sleep, I can't sleep, ring of joy, ring of joy.
We realized that more and more people were buying CDs, so we thought, well, here's these people that are growing up without turntables, and here's these songs that are only available on vinyl, so Pile Up was basically a collection of all the vinyl singles and compilation tracks that we've been putting out. But it was our best seller.
Pretty much any band on Lookout doubled its sales because of the Green Day Association and all the publicity that we got. But I would say during that same period, Pansy Division probably quadrupled their sales.
After the MTV thing, I think we sold 7,000 pileups in 1 week.
Which is kind of interesting because it had 7 originals and all the rest were covers. So to a certain extent, we were like, darn it, could have been one of our all original albums, but, you know, what the heck.
For us, that was higher than we ever expected to be in terms of popularity.
I was surprised, pleasantly, that they sold, you know, as well as they did, because there were certain things that they just didn't make a lot of concessions to, you know, sort of sticking pretty rigidly to their guns. You got to admire that in a band.
I think after Green Day hit, a lot of the more traditional pop punk bands, your Mr. T Experience, your Screeching Weasel, your Queers, your Squirt Gun, your, you know, name them all, whatever. You know, you go through the old Lookout catalogs. I think many of those bands figured, oh, they're next, you know, and they're the next ones who are going to, you know, get that golden ring and whatever. I don't think Pansy Division particularly were part of that because they were so explicitly gay.
After Green Day, things like any indie band was ripe for getting signed to a major label, except us. We were just too far beyond the pale.
Major labels, they couldn't touch us. I mean, when we went on tour with Green Day, we got to meet a lot of record people, and they basically said, we can't do anything with you. I mean, if you signed to us, what would we do? Big warning sticker. You'd never get sold in Walmart. You'd never get sold in any of the big chains.
There's just no way that you can rationalize getting us on the radio.
They said you're far more potent on an independent label.
So major labels are always like that until somebody does it, and then all of a sudden they say, oh my God, let me sign up everyone that's even remotely like that. So if they had gotten on a major label and done reasonably well, yes, you would have probably seen like hundreds of queercore bands.
The Lookout Records family used to be very tight-knit back in those days. And Pansy Division was a little bit on the outside, even though they were a San Francisco band. I remember the very first time we played with Pansy Division was in New York, of all places, Lookout Records CMJ Showcase. And the biggest impression they made on me at the time is that their drummer, who was Dustin, at that time played his cymbals way too high.
After coming off the Green Day tour, we were like, oh God, if only we had the killer drummer to play with us like Danny the whole time.
Danny was great on the tour, but he did want to stay in his other band, and even though I did get down on my knees and begged him, he would not join our band.
At that point, we needed to have a drummer that was good.
So finally, asking friends about drummers, we ended up with Dustin Donaldson.
Dustin was in a band called Thought Industry, which was heavily influenced by Skinny Puppy and Metallica at the time. He was really a great drummer.
We ended up doing Wish I'd Taken Pictures and a couple singles.
Wish I'd Taken Pictures got lots of good response from our audience. Basically, we had toughened up our sound. We went for more guitars, dirtier guitars. It was kind of our best foot forward on every level.
Hey there, I'm Matt Pinfield, your host for the next 120 minutes here on MTV. We'll show you brand new videos from Vervepipe, Pansy Division, Girls Against Boys, Love and Rockets.
As the sort of alternative indie thing was getting bigger and bigger, it seemed like MTV was going to be open to more bands getting on the air than just the ones that you would normally expect from the majors.
Thank you.
Very nice.
Thanks. We called in a lot of favors on that one.
You did film, you said?
Yes, on film, yeah, 16 millimeter.
It's beautiful.
Thanks.
Has it actually been on MTV yet?
Yes, it got played once.
And the music video only cost $5,000, which is nothing these days. But for a band like us, that was more than it cost to record our first three albums. Right after we did Wish I'd Taken Pictures, we did another single, and this was the metal single.
And you guys gave me that little EP. It was called For Those About to Suck Cock, We Salute You. That was a classic.
Thanks. It was fun.
Right on.
Yeah, it also has the Headbanger, which has Kirk Hammett playing on guitar on it.
Yeah, Kirk Hammett from Metallica, blade guitar on Headbanger Boy. Yeah,
that was fun.
We had a guitar solo scheduled for that song that I couldn't play. Dustin knew Kirk Hammett from Metallica, and he was hanging out with him once in a while. And he said, well, why don't we ask Kirk Hammett?
Yeah, you know, it's like when you put that EP out, I bumped into Kirk Hammett at a Misfits show.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I bumped into him. I go, hey, it's the Headbanger Boy. And he gave me a total dirty look and walked away.
Oh, he probably didn't know what you meant.
I think he should have known.
I think he really knew the song. I mean, we didn't even play the whole song for him. We just played the solo section, and he went, didn't even know what the song was about.
We kept it a secret for a while, but eventually it got back to him that people knew, and so he spilled the beans.
We think it's really funny to think that all those Metallica completists are gonna have to buy our single.
there are just some people who you should not be in a band with, because a band is a relationship. There's some people, you might like them, you might get along. You shouldn't be in a relationship with them, and that's the way it was with Dustin. We had personality clashes from the beginning, and we really tried to overlook them for a long time because he had made us sound better than we'd ever sounded.
You actually almost broke up, very, very close to breaking up, so we had to make changes, and we said, look, why don't you go pursue what you want to do? And now we're better friends. I mean, now we can talk, because at the end of it, we weren't even talking.
How do you like your current drummer?
He's great. Love him. Oh, he's our favorite.
I wanted to find a stable lineup. Bass player was easy. It took 5 years to find the right drummer.
So this is our new drummer, Luis. Hi.
I grew up in Tijuana, just south of the border in Mexico. And I was back and forth. My family moved to San Diego when I was 12. And then we moved back in my teenage years. So I spent my late teens and early 20s there in San Diego, and it was really fun. You know, it was really fun when you're young and you're trying to figure out what you're all about in between a bunch of different worlds of being involved with bands and kind of in the gay scene there, but not really that into it. Because I never really liked to go to like gay clubs or do any of the kind of what's considered activities in the community or whatever. And there was a really creative music scene at that time, and I think I really learned a lot from that.
When we met Luis, it was halfway through Dustin's tenure in the band, and I thought, someday we're going to need another drummer, and a gay drummer would be a good thing.
I was writing an article about Pansy Division for a local weekly in San Diego, so I went to the show to review the show. And then my roommates were all out of town. I was living in a big house, and so I invited them to stay there for the night because we had all these extra bedrooms. And they stayed there. And I remember John had to go to the hospital for some reason that night. And Dustin went to sleep. And so Chris and I stayed up all night listening to records. And one of those things that you really haven't met someone well, but you're really bonding over stuff, like pulling out, what do you think about this one? Oh, this is great. I like this, or I don't like that. What do you like about this? And we just geeked out on records all night. And I think we were kind of sniffing each other out, you know? And it was cool. It was cool. We were coming from this very much the same places in a lot of different ways, which I think maybe he filed away in the back of his brain in case they'd come to the point where they needed a drummer again.
When we were going through tapes of drummers, I remembered that I had this tape of Luis, and so I played it, and he was great. We called him up, and he had pretty much given up drumming for the most part and was concentrating on school. So we went down and talked him out of finishing school.
I had my finals in school early and just got out of there, quit my job, ended the relationship I was in, threw my stuff in a U-Haul and bailed. And I remember driving up and just feeling like I was free of everything and I was about to start whatever the next chapter was.
Look, look, look. Sharon Stone. Ah! Sharon Stone. That's
bad. So you guys are the rhythm section, right?
Yes.
How's it? What's it like keeping the beat?
Keeping the beat? It's hard because this motherfucker here. No, you can't say on TV. It's great, actually. He keeps me going.
He was not disciplined, but he could play very well. So we whipped him into shape for about a month and a half, and he's turned into a hell of a drummer. It's been amazing to watch him go from where he was to where he is now.
Plus, he's really cute, and we'd never had like a band sex symbol, so getting Luis in the band added to a certain appeal that we are happy to have.
But when it comes down to it, what is love? Nothing but a pain in my butt. It's because you don't relax before, dear.
We kind of got to know each other. It's been, yeah, a little over 10 years.
So we have 12 drummers in 15 years, but really we had 12 drummers in 5 years.
He's Why do you think it is that they have such drummer. A hard time finding a gay drummer?
I would say that because a lot of gay kids growing up don't just take up instruments and wanna start a band. I mean, I think it would be equally difficult to find, you know, a guitarist or a bass player. It was just as luck had it that they could find a good bass player, singer, guitar player, etc., that happened to be gay. And, you know, I think it was just circumstantial. But luckily it was me, so here I am.
He was so sweet and so easy to get along with, and then but we realized that he really hit his drums. Like when he played, he was loud.
We recorded a couple singles with Luis right after he joined the band. Now I'm stuck with a boy with hockey hair. I'm gonna be a
slut. I'm gonna be a slut. Look out! I thought when I first joined the band that they were gonna just have me be the drummer and that's it, or just kind of slowly work me in. But they were so welcoming from the first moment that I started playing with them. They started including me on a lot of decision making, and it's like I'd barely been in the band like 6 months. And I think it's because we were rehearsing together, playing shows together, spending time together. It just felt like it fit really well.
Are you straight, sir?
Oh.
You're straight?
I'm married to my palm.
What's that?
Very much so.
Very much so. Well, you know the difference between a straight guy and a gay guy?
No.
A six pack. There's a big bar right over there.
The first tour that we did with me and the band, I think it became really apparent, like by the first weekend of the tour, that we needed some extra muscle.
It just became clear with Luis as the drummer that our sound was lacking in the guitar department now that we had such a heavy-hitting drummer.
The songs that we were writing were just getting a bit thicker and stuff, and we just realized that we needed more like guitar leads or more, just a little more kick.
Once we got the drummer thing settled, then we thought, well, what else can we do here?
So we got a second guitar player, which was Patrick.
We'd like to introduce our newest member of the band, Patrick.
Hi. I just broke my strap.
I grew up in San Bernardino, California. I started playing in bands when I was like probably 13, 14 years old, playing guitar. And I played bass for a while in bands and played from anything from like pop to like metal to like, I was in a Christian heavy metal band at one point.
He had seen us in Denver with Green Day and had moved to San Francisco. And then I kept seeing him at shows and he'd record our shows. And I remember he gave me a Kiss Army shirt. Because he knew I was a Kiss fan.
Kiss!
He kept saying, you know, if you ever need a guitar player, I'd like to play.
I've actually known John and Chris for about a little over 2 years. I met them soon after I moved to San Francisco. And John was, like, kind of impressed because I was another queer into rock music, which is pretty damn rare.
It just worked. It was so perfect. And the songs just kind of took off.
And, you know, Luis joined the band, and he was this sex symbol. And Patrick, bearded Patrick, had bear appeal. So it was kind of expanding our audience in a way, too.
I thought it always was a great idea, like having a gay, out gay rock band, you know? I thought that was so perfect. And now it's just, it's amazing that I'm a part of it. You know, I always saw that and I was like, wow, that's so neat. It's like, I thought of it in my own terms, like, you know, I'd always be upfront with my sexuality, you know, no matter what I was doing.
I actually joined the band right before they were about to put out the More Love From Our Oven album. I'm gonna man it up, man it up, I'm gonna man it up.
been throwing out all these singles, and then decided that it would be a good time to compile them a la pile up.
I don't think we ever sounded as good as we did on that tour. We were so well rehearsed. We were feeling super enthusiastic about our songs. It was me, Chris, John, Patrick, all playing really well. I think that's the best this band ever sounded.
My old band, the Mr. T Experience, played a show with them at Slim's in San Francisco, and that was the first time I ever saw them, with Patrick on guitar, Luis on drums. And they sounded so amazing. And I remember being really worried that we had to follow it. Their act was so good, because they really had showmanship too, more than a lot of other Lookout Records bands. They had lights, they had props, and they had costume changes. So they really developed towards the end into a force to be reckoned with.
You can expect like a good, entertaining show. Our main purpose is to entertain the pants off of people, okay. No pun intended.
The set kind of goes along and has a pacing, and so there's all different things, costume changes, instrument changes, lots of things.
It's like Kiss on a smaller scale.
Yeah! Yeah.
You guys had a special guest at a show you guys did.
Yeah, we had Rob Halford from Judas Priest. Woo!
Pansy Division. How did you meet Pansy Division? You sang Breaking the Law with them with changed lyrics up on stage. That was amazing. How did you meet them, Rob?
I was playing a show in San Francisco, and I went to this club, and Chris, the bass player, came up and introduced himself.
I was in the audience, and Rob Halford was there, and I was like, oh my God, that's Rob Halford. I've got to talk to him. I've got to talk to him. So I walked up after the band was playing, and finished playing, and I said, are you Rob Halford? And he goes, oh yeah. And I said, I'm Chris from Pansy Division. And he grabbed my hand, he put it in both hands, shook it, and he's like, I'm really happy to meet you. And I said, well, I'm very happy to meet you too. I've been listening to you since I was 16, you know, and we do one of your songs, Breaking the Law. And he goes, oh, I know, I've heard it. It's great, man. Like in his English accent, I'm just like, ah. I said, well, we just played last night, so I can't invite you to a show, but you know, you live in Phoenix, so we're playing San Diego Gay Pride in a few weeks, and that's just, you know, a quick jump over from Phoenix. And he goes, oh, I go to San Diego Gay Pride. And I said, well, we're playing two shows, and, you know, maybe you'll come. And he said, oh, sure, I'll definitely come. And I said, well, if you come, then we'll play Breaking the Law for you. And then he said to me, well, if you play Breaking the Law, I'll sing it with you. I'm just like, okay.
When we became instant friends, and when they came to play San Diego, I went on stage and jammed Breaking the Law.
Their singer, Robin Halford, to help us sing it.
There's no longer rhythm. Thank you.
This is so awesome.
This is a special moment for me because Pansy Division have covered tunes by different people. They worked with Kirk Hammett from Metallica. They did a real cool version of a Nirvana song, and they got a real cool AC/DC cover. So now they've done me, and I feel like I've been inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. So, thank you so much.
This is Breaking the Law.
They're a wonderful band. They write incredibly good songs. They've got this kind of edgy, punky rock thing going for them. I think they're really cool guys.
Thank you so much. Thanks San Diego Pride for having us. Thank you all for being here. Thank you Rob Halford for sharing this heavy metal moment with us.
I think most music that gay people would think of as gay does not sound like what we do, and is kind of the opposite of what we do. It tends to be
absolutely
dance floor fodder. It's gay social music.
Yeah.
And
even though you can't talk around it. Yeah, I mean, it's so blisteringly loud in a gay bar, you can't talk over this.
crap that they're playing.
That's one of the things that's always struck me as being weird about gay bars, is that they play this music, it's there to dance, but if you go to a club where you're not going to dance, they still play this blaring dance music that's just really inappropriate.
Yeah, but it's also, it'll be like a sit down and drink bar and you hear this like booming, boom, 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 boom.
There's umpteen million examples of what the gay experience can be, and we're just saying that, you know, I'm tired of having one thing shoved down my throat. I don't want to live up to that. I want to be who I am. I didn't spend all that time being a teenager trying to find out who I am just in order to grab a whole new set of restraints and fit myself into that again.
People in the music scene tend to be very accepting of different ideas filtering through music. But people in the gay community don't seem to be very accepting of different ideas filtering through the gay community.
We would offend certain gay people because they felt we were reinforcing stereotypes. Other people would love us. They were like, oh, we've been waiting for you. So no matter what we said, somebody's going to oppose us.
Only a certain number of gay people like us or will come to our shows, buy our records. It's not for everybody within the gay world.
The longer they went on, the less gay audience they had. And they never had much of a gay audience.
As we've gone along, we've realized that this tag they sort of put on us, the homocore, queercore, emphasis on core, sort of chased away people that might have been interested in the first place.
And disappointed people who came to us thinking that we were this really raging punk band, but we've always been on the borderline between guitar pop music and punk rock.
Now with the, you know, the big boom and the popularization of punk rock, you know, become more stable and getting more radio play and things like that, it's become more stagnant.
When punk first started out, for me anyway, it was about being as different as you could from everything else. And right now, punk seems to be, you've got to sound as much like certain other bands as possible.
Now, as we see punk getting more and more boring, as it, you know, takes these strictures and just has these strict rules that punk bands feel like they have to play by, it just seems like such a rerun of earlier punk bands that we're like, okay, if that's punk, we're something else. So we went through an evolution of being very out, being very blunt, and to keep from making ourselves outmoded, we've changed, partly because we wanted to, partly because we know we needed to.
We're here at Steve Albini's house where we are recording our new album, Absurd Pop Song Romance. To get from the room where you actually record to the room where you actually go up and listen, you have to encounter the Steve Albini Stairmaster. It's tricky.
Well, I've got a van, and you're a beautiful man, but I'm just passing through, and your place just won't do. A dark, secluded spot in a deserted parking lot. Tinted windows are a wonderful thing.
We're keeping that, right?
Chance to be alone before we both must go. Sticky vinyl seats amplify every squeak. Tinted windows are a wonderful thing.
Right off the
save the album.
That, I think, was probably our most refined moment on record. I think we were really at our peak playing-wise and songwriting-wise.
I was really into it because it was a rocker of a record.
One, two, three.
Records like Absurd Pop Song Romance show that they aren't, quote unquote, just a gay band.
You're gonna need your friend. I'll tell you the inside.
It showed that they could write things that weren't gender specific.
And he looks in your eyes and tells you that this is the end. Yeah. My wish came true.
Third Pop Song Romance album was a really bold step for them in a different musical direction.
Please don't sing about love, 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 and it sounds like blah, 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 because they really mean sex, 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 sex. People just want to be mad. Love, 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 blah, 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 blah.
Felt like we had done our best work. It was the best sounding. We had horns, we had strings, we had everything. We were ready. We turned our record in, and Lookout had been sold. So Larry Livermore, who had signed us, was no longer a part of it.
Lookout had ceased to be fun for him after Green Day had become so huge, ironically, because they were selling so many copies of the Lookout records that it just changed the whole experience of being at Lookout. It became a big business. So he sold the label to the people who were working there, who were all very young.
And the people who were in charge of the label really weren't that keen on us because we had strayed so far from the Lookout sound.
Considering the position they were in, I think they pretty much blew it.
The promotion didn't get pushed in as much. We were on tour and up in Canada, and certain stores wouldn't have our records even, and we were like, you know, we were so frustrated with Lookout.
I started working at Lookout in 1997, and they were completely incompetent in terms of business and in terms of making smart decisions about who to sign, when to sign, how much money to put into them, what kind of money to spend where.
We gave them Absurd Pop Song Romance because of the loyalty we felt for the label, and they didn't give us the loyalty back. We'd been on tour constantly at that point. We didn't even have time to come home and wash our clothes. It was really, really hard. We booked it back to back to back.
We did 2 months US and Canada, then came home for like 2 days, and then did 2 months in Europe. And the second half of the European tour, so we started getting really tired, because we'd been out for like 3 months. And it was cold, and we were just staying in the worst places, you know, when you're just not well rested, but it's been months of that.
I ended up with walking pneumonia, and I got really bad food poisoning at one point. John had crazy asthma while we were there. Luis went to the hospital for his arm, and our tour manager broke her leg. So, oh, and we were ripped off in Spain.
We got really cranky with each other, and we got really burned out.
It was just killing us. You know, when you put four people in a small van for 7 months, you're living in each other's pockets, everyone's little personal habits start to get on your nerves. The first thing you want to do when you hit a new town is get out of the van And then after you get out of the van for a little while, then you start realizing you don't want to talk to anybody. So then you go back to the van, you sit in the van. So it becomes a real, it's like living in a bubble.
When you're in Europe, you're kind of isolated to yourselves, you know, because, you know, you don't necessarily know the layout, you don't always speak anything of the languages, and you don't know a lot of people there. So we recall, and we're all like together all the time in each other's face, and it just became unnerving.
You're constantly in motion, so everything that's your reality is, what am I going to eat right now? What are we going to do at the sound check? What time is the show? It's just what's directly ahead of you. And when you think that way for months on end, all the smallest things can seem like the biggest successes and the biggest failures, you know, because everything that's right ahead of you is your whole world. If you have a great show, man, you're on top of the world and everything's wonderful and you've got no care in the world. And if you have a bad meal, if you have a bad show, you're an utter failure. There's like, it's everything is just so dramatic.
When we got back, we were all pretty pissed off at each other. So it was a disaster of the tour, but I can kind of look at it and laugh now. At the time, we almost broke up because of this.
I think we just all felt a little bit disillusioned. I don't know if we, like, if we were being totally unrealistic or what the deal was. And so we weren't looking forward to spending a lot of time together because we just spent so much time together from writing the album to recording the album to being all that time in the van together. I think we were just burned out on each other.
We came home, we were just like so sick of each other and sick of our songs, sick of the same people on tour all the time. So we just thought, all right, let's take a break. And we didn't know how long the break was going to be. And that's when I decided to leave San Francisco. I'd had it.
He'd been living in the Castro a lot of this time, and he was just kind of fed up. So he wanted to change, so he moved to Los Angeles.
I think initially when I broke the news to John, he just said, well, this is the end of everything. And I said, no, I don't want it to be the end of everything.
He was very good about coming back and rehearsing on a regular basis.
I said, look, I will keep coming up every other weekend, whatever it's going to take to keep us going.
And then we had another album we wanted to do. And that was kind of hard to do with the limited people's limited availability.
We finished the album on the weekends, basically.
I ran into Chris on the street in San Francisco, and he was saying, oh yeah, we're recording a new record, we're thinking about doing this. And you know, I've always been a huge Pansy Division fan, so I was like, oh, that's fantastic, you know. And we, you know, I was like, I work at Alternative Tentacles. And so they got a hold of Jello and said, hey, here's your second chance to sign us.
We came back to do the Total Entertainment record, we had to just get our enthusiasm back. Because we wondered at that point, we're like, does anybody give a shit about this band at all? Like, should we even bother? And it was so much more fun because we had gotten rid of all of those expectations. Like, we're like, let's just do this for us.
It was a real attempt to try to get everybody in the band to contribute more rather than just me and Chris. But it was really hard to get Patrick especially motivated to work on stuff and get things done.
He didn't have as much time to be in Pansy Division as he used to, or as any band would need.
Yeah, I mean, I had other things going on that I needed to tend to. You're number one with the bullet. Your dirty air and strong
thighs. And you can't catch me when you're looking through many eyes. He's really a metal enthusiast, and he had started this band on the side. It was a total metal band that he was really into. And I think that he started taking it really seriously.
I think our songs were a little more simple. He wanted to play a little more heavy. Yeah, we're not going to be that heavy.
And ultimately, for him, it was the best thing.
When Pansy Division became less of a full-time thing, people in the band started having other side projects.
Luis was in at least three bands with me. We were in a band together called The Plus Ones, and we were also in a band together called The Avengers. Open your eyes to what you expected. Open your eyes, you can reject it. I actually have known the Pansy Division guys for years and years because I was in a Lookout Records band called The Mr. T Experience. What the fuck for? still in high school when I joined that band. I was 17 and we started touring right away. I did hundreds of dates a year with them between when I graduated high school in 2000, so that was definitely my time in the trenches. It was Luis who suggested that I had seen the band play enough times that I could just fill in, and I'm more of a bass player by trade, and I had no idea whether or not I could play guitar, but they were desperate enough, so.
It seemed a good fit for Joel because he's already playing in two other bands with Luis. Their availability would always be the same, and Joel was really good.
I feel like kind of at this point, we make a good partnership. I think the only thing that I wish I could be for them was gay. My other band with Luis, the Plus Ones, was going to be making an album, so we knew that we'd be in the studio with all the equipment we needed. If John and Chris had a couple of songs that they maybe wanted to see the light of day, then this was our chance to go in there and record them.
We all just said, why don't we just record just for fun? Let's just do it to have an experience together in a room and have some laughs.
It starts all together, right?
In the past, we've been a lot more focused because we've all been in the same city rehearsing these songs over and over again and getting them really tight and thinking about the concept of the record and how it's going to fit in.
We start all together?
But not at the top.
No.
And this time, we've all been in different cities. I'm living in New York. Chris is in LA. John's in San Francisco.
And then when it goes to, I've had 20 years of cock, then it's A-D-G-E. Okay.
So we just kind of came in and added our parts, and it came together
right.
Really smoothly.
Discussion about this song is gonna be hilarious. I know. But then when I get to cock, it goes to a G.
G, cock? I don't know. All right, let's give it a whirl.
How many cocks before the first fake ending?
One, two,
I'm getting older.
They went so well, and we had so much fun doing it, that we're going to make another record now in stages.
It may take another year or so, but I think it's going to get there.
We were having probably the best time we've had in 10 years, I would say. So there's no reason to stop. I mean, you know, what's 15 years? How many bands get to say they're 15 years old?
Hi, honey.
Yes?
I'm home!
Pansy Division was a band that was really hard to ignore. And elicited strong feelings in people, and still does today. It takes a lot for a band to actually get a reaction out of you at all. The fact that Pansy Division made a name for themselves and was noticed was pretty incredible, because not only did they do it, they did it in ways that took serious balls.
All of our lives, we've been told that being gay is something to be ashamed of. And we're saying no. I think that the happiness is the best revenge. We're well-adjusted, happy people, and you know, if you're gay, deal with it. It's like being left-handed or right-handed. You can't do anything about it. Just go with what you feel.
You just do your thing, whatever your thing is, and you find what's right for you, not what you think you're supposed to be or what you're supposed to live up to. And I think that's just more rewarding.
I think if you look at a retrospective about what this band has produced, it'll stand up over time.
Looking back at everything we've gone through, all the mind-blowing experiences we've had, it's been certainly a privilege. I thank John for coming up with the idea in the first place and for all the people who've supported us. It's been a great ride, and I don't expect it to end. We'll keep going as long as we can.
Yeah! Well, thank you so much. That's it for us. Good night.
We're ready for you.
Fucking around.